In prior videos, you learned how to calculate gross pay and whether the employee's payments for fringe benefits are pre-tax or post-tax deductions. Now we're ready for the next step of calculating federal income tax withholdings under the wage bracket method, one of the ways to calculate federal income tax. Another way is the percentage method of calculating federal income tax, which is covered in a separate video. You might be wondering why you're learning the manual method of calculating federal income tax withholdings for a paycheck. After all, there are a lot of payroll software programs that will do that automatically for you. One of the reasons is that as an accountant for a large company, for instance, you might be involved in system testing, and you want to make sure the system is still functioning as expected after an upgrade or other change. Typically, you would be expected to test the calculation and document your findings. In addition, how are you going to prove to an employee who comes to you with payroll withholding questions that the withholdings were calculated correctly? Mandatory deductions include federal income tax for all employees. This is an employee-only tax, which means that the employer does not contribute a matching amount like employers do for FICA tax. The starting point for calculating the federal withholdings is the Form W-4, which is completed by the employee on paper or online. The employer acts as the collector and depositor for these funds. When the employee files the income tax return, the amount withheld from his or her pay during the year reduces the amount they may have to pay with their tax return. It is important to note that federal income tax is reduced by pre-tax deductions, such as employees' payments for health insurance, 401k, and cafeteria plans. Many companies use software programs or an external service to calculate the federal income tax withholdings. However, if a company uses a manual system, there are two commonly used methods for calculating federal income tax: the wage bracket and the percentage method. Just remember that pre-tax deductions reduce the gross pay to arrive at taxable income. That means that we take the gross pay and subtract any pre-tax deductions such as 401k and health insurance to arrive at the amount we will be using to calculate federal income tax. In addition, the income tax liability is reduced by credits for children and other dependents. Let's look at two examples of how pre-tax deductions reduce period wages to arrive at taxable income. The first example is for Heather, who's employed with a period gross pay of $2,815. She elects to have 5% of her gross pay withheld for a 401k contribution and has no other pre-tax deductions. What will be her taxable income for federal income taxes? We start by writing down the gross pay of $2,815 and then calculate the 401k deduction, which is $2,815 times 5% or $140.75. We subtract the pre-tax deduction from the gross pay, which results in Heather's taxable income of $2,674.25. Could the gross pay and the taxable income be the same? Absolutely. If the employee has no deductions such as health insurance or 401k that qualifies to be deducted pre-tax, the employee's gross pay and taxable income would be the same. What about the next example? Bellamy has gross wages of $950, has subscribed to the company cafeteria plan, and has agreed to a 10% contribution of her gross wages in a qualified 401k plan. Bellamy's portion of the health insurance is $56.90. So first we'll write down the gross wages of $950 and calculate the 401k by multiplying 950 by 10%, which is $95. Write this amount down as a pre-tax deduction, then enter the pre-tax deduction for the health insurance of $56.90, arriving at taxable income of $798.10. Let's now talk about the wage bracket method for calculating federal income taxes. The first step for calculating the taxes is to identify the individual's marital status, number of exemptions, and taxable income level, and then follow the chart in Publication 15T or in your textbook for the amount to be withheld. If calculating the wage bracket method, it is important to apply the appropriate number of withholding variables before calculating the tax amounts. The wage bracket method is useful for manual payroll preparation because the process of federal tax withholding is an estimate for the year-end amount of taxes due. Let's look closer at this specific portion of the table. First, at the top is the title, 2023 Wage Bracket Tables for Manual Payroll Systems with Forms W-4 from 2020 or later. Below, and it's very important that you check this every time, is the time period. In this case, it is for a biweekly payroll period. Below that is the tax table that is divided into four major sections. The first section, we have the taxable income amounts, and be careful to read the header at least, but less than. The three other major sections are married filing jointly, head of household, and single or married filing separately. Why does each section have two columns? Well, the first one is for the standard withholding, and the second one is for employees who have chosen checkbox 2 withholdings on the form W-4. So let's say we have an employee who is paid biweekly and earned $755 during the payroll period. The employee is single and did not check box 2 on form W-4. What is the employee's federal tax withholding? First, we find the row in the first section that includes $755 and move to the right to the section that includes the employee's tax status of single, which is the last section. In that section, we choose the column standard withholding because the employee did not check box 2 on form W-4. The tax listed in that cell is $22. Now, what would happen if the employee is married filing jointly and everything else is the same? We find the section for married filing jointly and see that the tax withholding would be zero. Here we have an example for Jerry, who's an employee at Vosgian Farms. Jerry is single with no dependents and earns $48,000 annually, paid biweekly. We'll use the wage bracket tables in Appendix C to determine Jerry's federal income tax in three different situations. First, we'll calculate the federal income tax withholding, assuming that Jerry has no pre-tax deductions, by taking his annual pay and dividing it by 26 to get the gross wages per period, which is $1,846.15. We then go to Appendix C of your textbook or Publication 15T to find the biweekly payroll period for the wage bracket. When looking at the tax table, it's important to ensure that you have the right table. We're looking for the table that shows 2023 wage bracket method tables for manual payroll systems for form W-4 from 2020 or later. We also need to find the table that shows biweekly payroll. Then we need to locate the correct marital status column and the correct wage row that shows the wage we're looking for. For Jerry, we need to find the row that includes his wage of $1,846.15, which is about in the middle of the page. It's the row that starts with 1,840 and ends with the wages less than 1,860. Then we move to the right until we find the standard withholding column for single taxpayers, and we find $150. How do the withholdings change when Jerry has pre-tax deductions for health insurance of $75 and supplemental health insurance deductions of $55? Well, Jerry's taxable income decreases to $1,716.15. because the insurance contributions are pre-tax deductions. So we now look up $1,716.15 in the tax table and find $133 for tax withholdings. Our last example is like the second example, but we have an additional pre-tax deduction for 401k of $100, which lowers the taxable income to $1,616.15. Going back to the tax table, we find the correct row for the taxable income of $1,616.15, which is $121. Here's another example that illustrates what we have to do when the employees have dependents and box 2 of form W-4 is checked. Wolf Industries pays its employees on a semi-monthly basis. Using the wage bracket tables in Appendix C or Publication 15T, compute the federal income tax deductions for the following employees of Wolf Industries. No information was included in Step 4 of any W-4. McCollum checked the box in Step 2C. Assume that no pre-tax deductions exist for any employee, and Box 2 is not checked for all other employees. So let's look at T. Cantor. This employee has taxable income of $1,205, and the filing status is single, and there are no dependents. There are no pre-tax deductions, and therefore the gross income is also the taxable income, which we will use to look up the tax in the semi-monthly tax table, which is highlighted with the green rectangle and shows $66. Now let's look at McCollum. McCollum is married filing jointly, has two dependents under 17. For this employee, you also have to remember that the box 2C is checked. We'll pull up the tax table and we see that the tax for a wage of $1,655 is $135, which is highlighted with the blue rectangle here. Remember that we have to choose the second column because McCollum checked box 2 on form W-4. After finding the tax in the table, the employee's federal taxes is reduced by the two dependents under 17. Each dependent is worth $2,000 as an annual tax reduction. That means we multiply $2,000 by two dependents and then divide the $4,000 by 24 because it's a semi-monthly payroll, which results in a reduction of $166.67 and reduces the total tax down to zero. High has taxable income of $1,945 and a marital status of head of household. We look up his tax in the tax table and come up with $118. We still need to subtract the tax reduction for High's dependent of $1,000 per year or $83.33 per semi-monthly pay period, which results in a final tax of $34.67. Elliot has taxable income of $2,065 and is single. We look up the tax in the tax table and come up with $171. We still need to subtract the tax reduction for Elliot's dependent, which is $500 per year because this is an other dependent. Per semi-monthly pay period, the dependent is worth a reduction of $20.83, which results in a final tax of $150.17. Here's another example that illustrates what we have to do when the employees have dependents, as well as additional withholdings from a spouse's income. Mauro Vanti Italian Imports has four employees and pays biweekly. Assume that box 2 is not checked for L. Tarabi and R. Beninati and is checked for G. Fisher and J. Tillman. The first two employees, Tarabi and Beninati, are very similar to the prior examples. And that's why I won't go over the detailed calculations. Please make sure that you're comfortable with the calculations. Now let's look at Fisher. Fisher is married filing jointly and has three dependents under 17. The annual salary is $54,000 and the spouse's salary is $90,000. We'll first calculate the biweekly wages of $2,076.92 and look up the federal income tax in the biweekly table. It's $176. So let's write down the tax that we found in the tax table. The three dependents are worth $2,000 each for a total of $6,000, which we divide by 26 to get the biweekly reduction of $230.77. We subtract the dependent deduction from the tax we previously looked up of $176 and come up with a tax of zero because the dependent deductions do not result in negative taxes. We're not done yet, though. We need to look up the additional taxes because the spouse had income, and we do that on form W-4 on page 3 and 4. To determine the additional tax, we start with page 3, of Form W-4 and enter the amount from the Page 4 table. Make sure you're picking the table for the correct tax status. In our case, that's married filing jointly. We find the intersection between the wages of the two spouses. Be careful to choose the column with the lowest wages and the row with the highest wages. The intersection for G. Fisher is $7,600, and we enter that amount on page 3, line 1. We don't need to complete line 2 because G. Fisher and spouse do not have a third job. On line 3, we enter the number of pay periods for the highest paying job, which is G. Fisher's spouse. The spouse is paid biweekly, and we enter 26. On line 4, we divide 7,600 by 26 and enter the result of $292.31. Since G. Fisher is the spouse with the lower paying job, the amount is not added to his federal withholdings because line 4 indicates that the amount is entered for the highest paying job. I showed you how to complete the worksheet on page 3 to illustrate the process, but you only need to determine if the employee's spouse has the higher paying job, and in that case, there is no additional tax. Let's now look at Jay Tillman. Tillman is married, filing jointly, and has two dependents under 17. The annual salary is $39,100, and the spouse's salary is $23,460. We'll first calculate the biweekly wages of $1,503.85 and look up the federal income tax in the biweekly table. It's $109. The two dependents are worth $2,000 each for a total of $4,000, which we divide by 26 to get the biweekly reduction of $153.85. We subtract the dependent deduction from the tax we previously looked up of $109 and come up with a tax of zero. We're not done yet, though. We need to look up the additional taxes because the spouse has income, and we do that on Form W-4 on pages 3 and 4. The intersection between Tillman's salary of $39,100 and the spouse's salary of $23,460 is $3,120, which we divide by Tillman's pay frequency of 26 and arrive at $120. Tillman is the spouse with the higher wage amount, and therefore the additional tax is added to his interim tax calculation, and we arrive at a final income tax of $120.